Good morning. This is the Subcommittee on Immigration and Border Security. It's a hearing on H.R. 1772, the Legal Workforce Act. The subcommittee will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recesses of the committee at any time. We welcome everyone to today's hearing on the Legal Workforce Act. I will introduce the witnesses, and we thank you for your presence and your expertise. I will introduce you later, but for now, I will recognize the gentleman from the great state of Texas, Mr. Lamar Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate your yielding me time and giving me the opportunity to talk about this piece of legislation, which I introduced in the last Congress and hope to introduce in the next few days in this Congress. Mr. Chairman, almost 20 million Americans are unemployed or underemployed. Meanwhile, 7 million people are working in the United States illegally. These jobs should go to American citizens and legal workers who need these jobs. The Legal Workforce Act turns off the jobs magnet that attracts so many illegal immigrants to the United States. The bill expands the E-Verify system and applies it to all U.S. employers. Illegal workers cost American jobs or depress their wages, according to nearly all studies on the subject. For example, a Center for Immigration Studies report found that illegal immigration reduces the wages of American workers by approximately $650 per worker. We need to do all we can to protect the jobs and wages of American workers. The Legal Workforce Act also would open up millions of jobs for unemployed Americans by requiring employers to use E-Verify. The E-Verify system is quick and effective, confirming 99.7% of work-eligible employees. Recent data shows that approximately 575,000 American employers voluntarily use E-Verify already, and an average of 1,400 new businesses sign up each week for E-Verify. One-third of American jobs are now covered by E-Verify. The program is free, quick, and easy to use. In fact, E-Verify will soon be available for use on smartphones. It will take about 1 minute per potential employee. Individuals provide their Social Security number when they visit a doctor, open a bank account, or buy a home. It makes sense that other businesses should check the status of prospective employees to ensure that they have a legal workforce. The Legal Workforce Act requires that U.S. employers use E-Verify to check the work eligibility of new hires in the U.S. The verification period is phased in and depends on the size of the employer's business. Smaller businesses have up to 2 years to implement E-Verify. The legislation balances immigration enforcement priorities and legitimate employer concerns. It gives employers a workable system under which they cannot be held liable if they use the system in good faith. The bill prevents a patchwork of state E-Verify laws, but retains the ability of states and localities to condition business licenses on the use of E-Verify. It also allows states to enforce the federal E-Verify requirement if the federal government fails to do so. The Legal Workforce Act increases penalties on employers who knowingly violate the requirements of E-Verify and imposes criminal penalties on employers and employees who engage in or facilitate identity theft. The bill creates a fully electronic employment eligibility verification system, and it allows employers to voluntarily check their current workforce if done in a non-discriminatory manner. Furthermore, the Legal Workforce Act gives U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services the ability to prevent identity theft. The bill allows individuals to lock their own Social Security number so that it cannot be used by others to verify work eligibility. The legislation also allows parents to lock the Social Security number of a minor child to prevent identity theft. If a Social Security number shows unusual multiple uses, the Social Security Administration locks the number for employment verification purposes and notifies the owner that their personal information may be compromised. A report by Westat in 2009 on error rates and the cost of E-Verify is clearly outdated. That study utilized old data and failed to consider the provisions aimed at preventing identity theft mentioned above and that are in the bill today. In regard to cost, one study showed that 3/4 of employers stated the cost of using E-Verify is zero. Equally important, the American people support E-Verify. Last month, a Paragon Insights poll showed that 71% of voters, quote, support Congress passing new legislation that strengthens the rules making it illegal for businesses in the U.S. to hire illegal immigrants, end quote. In fact, E-Verify receives the most public support of any immigration reform provision. Unfortunately, many states do not enforce their own E-Verify laws, and others only apply E-Verify in a very limited way. The Legal Workforce Act helps ensure that employers from every state have the same standard when it comes to hiring employees. This bill is a common sense approach that will reduce illegal immigration and save jobs for American workers and legal workers. It deserves the support of everyone who wants to put the interest of U.S. workers first. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'll yield back.
Thank the gentleman from Texas. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Michigan, the ranking member, former chairman of the Judiciary Committee, Mr. Conyers.
Thank you, Chairman Gowdy. This is a subject that of today's hearing that's very familiar to us because over the past 4 years, this same subcommittee has held 6 hearings on E-Verify, the government's electronic employment verification system. Each time that we've looked at it, each time we've considered the Legal Workforce Act, I have also said that E-Verify is an important tool. But I've also said, and the witnesses appearing before us have agreed, that E-Verify cannot be made mandatory for all employers without comprehensive reforms to our nation's broken immigration system. That's a very important point. We must, the E-Verify cannot be made mandatory for all employers without comprehensive reforms to our nation's immigration system. For years, some have argued that to fix the broken system, we need only enforce the laws on the books. But we know that's not a real and viable solution. We cannot rely solely upon enforcement of our broken laws. The truth is that enforcement without reform will actually hurt the American worker. But if we fix our broken immigration system, we can help American workers and grow our economy. Or to put it another way, the Congressional Budget Office told us in December that enacting this bill into law would increase the deficit by $30 billion over 10 years. Who came up with that? But enacting the Senate-passed immigration reform bill, S-744, would in fact reduce the budget deficit by $158 billion over the first 10 years and by about $680 billion over the next 10 years. I want to get into that in the hearing. Whenever we talk about E-Verify, it's important that we think about how the world really works. I've heard people say that E-Verify will help American workers because every time an undocumented immigrant is denied a job, an unemployed American gets hired. Pretty simple idea, and I can see how it could be appealing, but the problem is that it is false. Take a look. Immigrants often fill gaps in our own workforce where there are not enough Americans willing to do the work. Because 50 to 70% of the nation's farm workers are undocumented, mandatory E-Verify would be especially devastating to that industry. No one would pick the fruits and vegetables in the fields, and they would probably be left to rot. American farms would go under, and jobs would be moved overseas, including the millions of upstream and downstream American jobs supported by agriculture. Now, when we first considered this bill in the 112th Congress, the Legal Workforce Act contained a simple solution for the agriculture industry. It created a special carve-out in the law to exempt farmers from the requirement to use E-Verify. And in the final days of the 113th Congress, this committee reported to the floor this bill and an agricultural guest worker bill, but in part because the guest worker proposal didn't have much support, neither bill went anywhere. Finally, E-Verify could already be required for employers around the country. Had my conservative friends in the House taken up the bipartisan comprehensive immigration reform bill passed by the Senate way back in 2006, mandatory E-Verify would be the law today. And had House Republicans taken up S-744, the bipartisan comprehensive immigration reform that passed the Senate with a supermajority in the last Congress, or H.R. 15, the bipartisan bill in the House, mandatory E-Verify, again would be the law of the day. And so instead, our Republican leaders in the House chose not to act on either of these proposals. They withered on the vine and died, just as the crops would go unpicked if this bill were to become law without broader changes to our immigration system. So I look forward to the hearings, and I want to welcome all of the witnesses to today's hearings. And I thank the chairman and yield back any time remaining.
Thank the gentleman from Michigan. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Virginia, the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Goodlatte.
I thank the gentleman from South Carolina for holding this hearing, and I thank the gentleman from Texas, to my immediate right here, for once again championing the Legal Workforce Act. It will play an integral role in the enforcement of U.S. immigration laws and the discontinuation of the jobs magnet responsible for so much illegal immigration. Americans have long been promised tougher immigration enforcement in exchange for the legalization of those unlawfully in the U.S. But administrations never kept these promises, and today we are left with a broken immigration system. One way to make sure we discourage illegal immigration in the future is to prevent unlawful immigrants from getting jobs in the U.S. Requiring the use of E-Verify by all employers across the country will help do just that. The web-based program is a reliable and quick way for employers to electronically check the work eligibility of newly hired employees. The Legal Workforce Act, as reported out of this committee last Congress, builds on E-Verify's success and helps ensure the strong enforcement that was promised to the American people many years ago. But the bill doesn't simply leave enforcement up to the federal government. In fact, it actually empowers states to help enforce the law, ensuring that we don't continue the situation we have currently, where a president can turn off federal enforcement efforts unilaterally. Nearly 575,000 employers are currently signed up to use E-Verify. It is easy for employers to use and is effective. In fact, as USCIS testified in front of this subcommittee last Congress, E-Verify immediately confirms the work eligibility of persons eligible to work 99.7% of the time. But the system is not perfect. For instance, in cases of identity theft, when an individual submits stolen identity documents and information, E-Verify may confirm the work eligibility of that individual. This happens because E-Verify uses a Social Security number or alien identification number and certain other corresponding identifying information, such as the name and date of birth of an individual, to determine if the SSN or alien identification number associated with that corresponding information is work eligible. Thus, if an individual uses a stolen Social Security number and the real name corresponding with that Social Security number, a false positive result could occur. The Legal Workforce Act addresses identity theft in several ways. First, it requires notification to employees who submit for E-Verify an SSN that shows a pattern of unusual multiple use. In this way, the rightful owner of the SSN will know that their SSN may have been compromised. And once they confirm this, DHS and the Social Security Administration must lock that SSN so no one else can use it for employment eligibility purposes. The bill also creates a program through which parents or legal guardians can lock the Social Security numbers of their minor children for work eligibility purposes. This is to combat the rise in the number of thefts of children's identities. The bill also phases in E-Verify use in six-month increments, beginning with the largest U.S. businesses, raises penalties for employers who don't use E-Verify according to the requirements, allows employers to use E-Verify prior to the date they hire an employee, and provides meaningful safe harbors for employers who use the system in good faith. The witness testimony and other support proffered today will show that the Legal Workforce Act balances the needs of the American people regarding immigration enforcement with the needs of the business community regarding a fair and workable electronic employment verification system. I will continue to work with my colleagues and other stakeholders to address any additional concerns with the bill as we move it through the committee, and I look forward to the witness's testimony today and welcome all of you here and yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the chairman. The chair will now recognize the gentlelady from the great state of Texas, Ms. Jackson Lee.
I thank the chairman very much, and I acknowledge the indication that the ranking member of this committee had to be called away today, and I thank you and her for this hearing and offer this statement on behalf of the Subcommittee on Immigration and Border Security. Let me be clear at the outset that E-Verify is an important tool for the future, but it needs to be made mandatory at the right time and in the right way. The bill that we marked up in the summer of 2013 had many good features to it, but it did not meet those two important requirements. Let me also say that I do this and make this statement in the backdrop of the need for comprehensive immigration reform, and would simply ask the question, wouldn't this be a better approach if we did have a comprehensive approach? Let me state it plainly, E-Verify cannot be made mandatory for all employees until having first enacted comprehensive immigration reform, because E-Verify without that would have devastating, though unintended, consequences. One possibility is that it would essentially drive 8 million undocumented workers out of the workforce, which would devastate many industries that depend upon that workforce, especially in agriculture. And I would venture to say that it would be an uncertainty as to whether or not there would be enough buses to bus 8 million individuals back to their home country. Another possibility is that it would drive those 8 million undocumented workers even further under the radar and off of the books, and that's what led CBO to find that enacting this bill into law would raise the deficit by $30 billion over 10 years. So, Chairman, if we're going to do E-Verify the right way, we agree with much of what is in the law, but there are deficiencies in this bill that we highlighted during the markup last Congress and that we've detailed in our dissenting views. The lack of due process for workers who are harmed by erroneous non-confirmations, provisions that will facilitate discrimination and inappropriate bars to proper judicial relief, and unnecessary and inappropriate ban on class action lawsuits, for instance. E-Verify has the potential to be an important tool in the effort to address unauthorized employment, but if done in isolation, as the legal workforce does, it would inflict the tremendous harm on American workers, businesses, and the economy. I'm also concerned that requiring the use of E-Verify will cause many Texas workers to lose their jobs. The rush to implement a flawed E-Verify program across the board is guaranteed to hurt thousands of authorized U.S. workers, like people in the 18th Congressional District, my district, who need good jobs, but will be erroneously denied employment authorization by errors in the system. The system is heavily overburdened and can be if it is not a sophisticated system. The bill would also hit small businesses, particularly hard, imposing significant burdens on very small firms that may not even have human resource departments, but would still have to use the new system, even those with only a single employee. But I also think of small mom-and-pop restaurants, which would face that, and I noticed that the National Restaurant Association is here, and I hope that they would consider that as they represent their large restaurateurs about the mom-and-pop restaurants. E-Verify would actually exacerbate Texas unemployment, according to estimates based on government sources. If the entire U.S. workforce were required to have its employment eligibility verified through E-Verify, a conservative estimate is that between 1.2 million and 3.5 million U.S. citizens and authorized immigrants would either have to correct their records or lose their jobs. Extrapolating from these estimates, approximately 101,000 to 291,000 citizens and authorized immigrant workers in Texas would have to correct their records in order to avoid being fired. In Texas, approximately 19.3% of the labor force is comprised of foreign-born workers. Foreign-born workers authorized for employment have encountered a disproportionate E-Verify error rate 20 times greater than the U.S.-born employees. If we were to use a rough estimate, this would affect up to 63,495 legal workers in Texas. I would note that in yesterday's rules committees, the number of bills were considered relevant on this very issue. Lastly, we consider how E-Verify will decimate the agriculture industry. We've heard a lot of that from Mr. Conyers. And so I would simply say that in joining on his point, I conclude by reiterating we need a larger system to deal with E-Verify. And I hope as the witnesses present their testimony, they will with good intentions tell us, do you believe in comprehensive immigration reform? That should be put on the table because I know there's several groups at that table who represented to me that they support comprehensive immigration reform. With that, I yield back.
Thank you, gentlelady. Without objection, additional members' opening statements will be made part of the record. And before I recognize our witnesses, I would ask unanimous consent to put in the record letters of support from the International Franchise Association, National Association of Home Builders, and Numbers USA. With that, I welcome our distinguished panel. I will begin by asking you to please rise so I can administer an oath to you. Do you swear the testimony you're about to give should be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Let the record reflect everyone answered in the affirmative. I will introduce you en banc, and then I will recognize you individually for your five-minute opening statement. The lights, despite the fact that we don't always honor them, the lights mean what they traditionally mean in life. Yellow means you have about a minute left, and red means if you would conclude whatever remark you are in the middle of. Randall K. Johnson is a Senior Vice President, U.S. Chamber of Commerce for Labor, Immigration, Employment Benefits. Before joining the Chamber, he served as counsel to the U.S. House of Representatives Committee on Education and the Workforce. He's a graduate of Denison University, the University of Maryland School of Law, and earned his Master of Laws in Labor Relations from Georgetown. Ms. Jill Blitzstein is here on behalf of the College and University Professional Association for Human Resources. She is currently the International Employment Manager at NC State University. In this position, she oversees the employment eligibility verification process and compliance procedures at NC State. Prior to joining NC State, she was senior associate with a Chicago law firm that I cannot pronounce most of the names of that firm, but I'm sure it was very distinguished. From 1997 to 2007, Ms. Blitzstein received her law degree from DePaul University College of Law in 1995. Mr. Angelo Amador, is that close? Is Senior Vice President and Regulatory Counsel for the National Restaurant Association. He advocates on behalf of the National Restaurant Association, its members before the U.S. Congress and the Executive Branch. Prior to joining the NRA, not that NRA, the National Restaurant Association, served as an Executive Director in Labor, Immigration, and Employment Benefits Division of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and as an Adjunct Professor of Law at the George Mason University School of Law. He's a graduate of the Robert H. Smith School of Business at the University of Maryland, obtained a Master's in Arts in International Transactions from George Mason, and a JD from George Mason, graduating with honors. Lastly, Mr. Chuck Connor is President, Chief Executive Officer, National Council of Farm Cooperatives, a D.C.-based trade association representing the interests of U.S. agricultural cooperatives. He has more than 25 years of national and state government, agricultural and trade association experience. Prior to joining the NCFC, he served as acting director and deputy director for the U.S. Department of Agriculture. He's a graduate of Purdue University with a Bachelor's of Science and recipient of Purdue's Distinguished Alumni Award. Welcome each and every one of you, and Mr. Johnson will recognize you for your opening statement.
Well, thank you, Chairman Gowdy. And as Mr. Conyers suggested, we have been at this for some time, and in the earlier days when Chambers testified, I think at the same table, we in fact, as Mr. Smith knows, opposed mandatory E-Verify. Of course, for a lot of good reasons back then, but the chamber can change, and as times change and as the years went by and more of our members engaged the system voluntarily, and frankly, while we were watching things on Capitol Hill and in the courts and in the states, we decided to reevaluate our position, and we put together an extensive task force back in January 2011, almost 5 years ago now, comprised of a cross-section of our members. We drew that from our Immigration Policy Subcommittee with input from our Small Business Council, and said, well, we need to take a look at E-Verify. What do we need to sort of buy into a mandate if we can? And obviously at the chamber, and I've been there now 16 years, I think there's only been one other time I've ever testified to agreeing to a new mandate on our members. We take that very seriously and very carefully. One reason I love my job, and I'm not gonna agree to a mandate for the chamber unless our members are behind me. And in this case, they were. And that ranges from the larger businesses and the smaller businesses. So I'm pleased to say today that we do support a mandatory E-Verify system, and the act that we worked together with principally Mr. Smith on. And let me just kind of go through the sort of variations or the issues that we talked about. First of all, and I think this is important to note, it's certainly in my written testimony, but it was suggested by further speakers, there have been a lot of technical improvements on E-Verify over the years. This system certainly has gotten better as the kinks have been worked out. There are errors, but there's less errors than before. It'd be better if there were no errors, but when you're down to approximately 0.3% error rate, I think that's something to be bragged about, and we're never going to get down to a zero rate unless we start rolling this out to more people and continue to work out the costs. With regard to costs, I know there's some, and Mr. Smith, you talked about this, there's a lot of misinformation out there. A lot of economists have looked at this. I can tell you our economists have looked at the studies out there that talk about something like $2.7 billion. Economists can come up with lots of studies. We all know that. The bottom line is that for my members, we hear they can adapt to this system quite easily, and the costs are quite minimal. If anything, they are principally concerned about costs of re-verification if, in fact, the law went that direction, which firstly it doesn't. Third, preemption. Mr. Goodluck touched on this. Preemption of state laws. We have mostly multinational companies, but we also have small businesses that work across state lines. And we had to have in a bill that we could support a preemption of state law, state and local laws. The language in the bill is a balancing of various interests in this. Would we have rather had blanket preemption, such as under ERISA or the National Labor Relations Act? Sure, but we have to understand that compromises have to be made, and that compromises are reflected in this act. Fourth, we cannot support a blanket re-verification of an existing workforce. One doesn't have to be a genius to think about the burdens and obligations that would accrue to, say, an IBM that had to re-verify its 10,000 workers, et cetera. And in reality, because we have such high turnover in this day and age, essentially the workforce often will recycle through a new E-Verify system. Fifth, we also need to have sorts of safe harbors, and which are reflected in the Act. I do want to mention that the Act does protect the contractor and subcontractor relationship. And Chairman Gowdy, when at a time when the National Labor Relations Board is revisiting the whole area of joint employer liability, we're pleased that the Act in front of the committee today isolates contractor and subcontractor liability from each other. And lastly, I want to close with saying that I think 800-pound gorilla in the room here is what do we do about the agricultural industry? I know everyone on the dais is attuned to this, but surely I think before an E-Verify bill goes to the floor, you all have to figure out what do we do about the agricultural industry, whether it's a fix in the guest worker program or legalization. I'm not smart enough to say. That certainly is in their world, but something has to be done in that area. And with that, let me just say that we still remain committed to immigration reform in other areas, Mrs. Lee, and I'm sure that'll come up in the Q&A. The Legal Workforce Act is a key aspect, a key underpinning of other reforms. But certainly it's one important aspect of those reforms, whether it proceeds to the floor jointly with other bills or separately, I'm not here to say. But we are certainly committed to other parts of immigration reform. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Ms. Blitzstein.
Chairman Gowdy, honorable members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to express support for the Legal Workforce Act. I am the International Employment Manager at North Carolina State University. NC State is an active member of the College and University Professional Association for Human Resources. CUPA HR represents more than 1,900 educational institutions, 44% of which are public. And I'm speaking to you today on behalf of CUPA HR. My institution has been using E-Verify since January 1st, 2007, when it was mandated by the state of North Carolina for all public agencies and for the university system. I have responsibility for NC State's I-9 and E-Verify processes. With more than 8,000 regular employees and almost 8,000 more student and temporary workers, including foreign nationals, our use of the I-9 and E-Verify process is constant. I will speak to you today as someone who has experienced the favorable effects of this program, as well as someone who can offer a few informed suggestions as to its implementation. CUPA HR supports the majority of positions within the Act as being positive for both employers and employees, including the reduction in the number of acceptable documents to prove identity and employment authorization. Many documents on the current list are confusing or rarely used, so streamlining them will add a much-needed clarity to the process, facilitating faster and easier compliance for everyone involved. Additionally, CUPA HR strongly supports the recognition of a good faith defense based on compliance with the processes of the Act. As an example, NC State has relied on E-Verify final non-confirmations to justify the termination of employment of some of our employees. CUPA HR especially supports the Act's clear preemption of state and local law on employment verification. Having a single national verification process is extremely important, not only from a national policy perspective, but also from a practical standpoint from an employer with employees across the U.S. As a collaborative research institution, NC State has employees in over 40 states. The current patchwork of policies and laws around the country make it incredibly difficult for employers like us to know and comply with each jurisdiction's rules regarding employment eligibility verification. NC State never experienced the worst-case scenarios that circulated several years ago regarding fears of excessive final non-confirmation results. And in the 8 years that we have used E-Verify, we have received almost instantaneous employment verification results for the majority of our employees. We believe the employment verification process works as intended. That said, based on direct experience, we do have a few suggestions regarding the current Act. It would require that within 6 months after enactment, all federal, state, and local government employers verify employment eligibility for any employees not already in the E-Verify system. Having verified the entire workforce at NC State University, I can tell you with confidence that that is not a realistic timeframe in which to achieve full compliance for large employers. Based on an amended executive order in 2009, NC State was required to either verify employees constantly as they came and went on certain federal contracts or to verify all employees. We quickly realized that our best option was to verify our entire workforce, meaning every active employee hired before January 1st, 2007. We had to enter data from approximately 12,000 I-9 forms into E-Verify within 6 months to achieve compliance, and it took us 7 months to accomplish that goal. The time and effort required was significant, and since then, we have invested in an electronic system to help manage our process. CUPA HR would encourage consideration of a 24-month phased rollout compliance timeframe, particularly for the largest public employers. CUPA HR would also like to recommend that the timeframe for verifying foreign national employees who have applied for a Social Security account number be extended beyond the proposed 3 days after the actual receipt of their new number. As an employer with approximately 1,000 foreign national workers and employees every year, it is impossible for NC State as the employer to know exactly when a new employee receives his or her new number. Consequently, we have no realistic way to know when this 3-day requirement to finish E-Verify would begin or end. Lastly, CUPA HR also suggests that the verification process, which is currently 3 business days after the hire date, be extended to at least 5 business days after the hire date. Any large employer can tell you that performing the required identity and employment authorization verification check within the 3 business days is incredibly labor intensive. Despite best efforts, meeting this deadline is a constant source of frustration, even for those employers most committed to compliance. In closing, the Legal Workforce Act is a balanced approach to creating a more secure and flexible employment verification system. CUPA HR respectfully encourages the committee to consider some of the suggestions we have offered today, and we are grateful for your time and attention, and I personally thank you for this opportunity to testify.
Thank you, Ms. Blitzstein. Mr. Amador, I want to congratulate you on that beautiful tie you have on with the seal from the state of South Carolina. It did not go unnoticed, so I will direct no questions towards you today, but you are recognized for 5 minutes.
I knew I were for a good reason. Good morning, Chairman Gowdy, Congressman Conyers, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. Special greetings to Congressman Pierluisi, who actually broke me into doing policy here in Washington, D.C. He's always glad to see you here. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to represent the National Restaurant Association. My name is Angelo Amador, and I am the Senior Vice President and Regulatory Counsel for the National Restaurant Association. The National Restaurant Association believes that the Legal Workforce Act is a thoughtful, balanced approach to implementing a major change related to workplace hiring for employers. We appreciate the bill sponsors and the subcommittee's efforts to think through the real-world implementation of a universal E-Verify mandate. Put in context, the mandate, once implemented, will be the final hurdle that every U.S. employer must clear for each and every hiring decision made in the United States. In our industry, with naturally high turnover rates and one that is so reliant on a robust workforce, the details of how this system is implemented is incredibly important. While I touch on a number of other issues in my written statement, I would like to address four key areas of concern in the implementation of a mandatory E-Verify program. Before I go into those four, I will reiterate as well that we oppose re-verification of the entire workforce, which is one of the reasons, not the only reason, that we supported King's Amendment during the last Congress, the last markup, that allows re-verification of certain workers for good cause. But the four that I want to talk about today, the first one is federal preemption. We believe that designing an employment authorization verification system is without question a federal role. Actions by 50 different states and numerous local governments in passing a patchwork quilt of employment verification laws creates an untenable system for employers and their prospective employees. Under the Legal Workforce Act, states and localities are preempted from legislating different requirements or imposing additional penalties. However, they may enforce a federal law and also revoke a business license for failure to participate in the program. As the Chamber stated, we also would prefer a blanket preemption, but we understand the need to reach a balance. Second, safe harbor. Full and fair enforcement of an improved E-Verify system should protect employers acting in good faith. Piling on fines and other penalties for even small paperwork errors, punishing the people who are trying to do the right thing is not the answer. The Legal Workforce Act states that an employer cannot be held liable for good faith reliance on information provided through the E-Verify system. We strongly support this provision and believe that no employer who's using the system in good faith should be held liable by the government for relying on information provided by the government's database that turned out to be incorrect. Likewise, we also strongly believe that employers should not be held liable by an employee or a worker they chose not to hire as a result of a faulty information provided by the government's database. Now, we're not saying they shouldn't have recourse, but the recourse should be on the employer. Third, early verification. We support the provision in the bill that allows verification when an offer of employment is extended, and making that offer condition on final verification of the identity and employment eligibility of the employee. Employers should be given authority to check work authorization when an offer of employment is made. In those cases where a temporary non-confirmation is issued, it allows the employee to start working with the government as soon as possible to fix any discrepancies before they show up for the first day of work. After all, you can do all of the other background checks beforehand as well. Finally, employment laws. There are already existing laws governing wage requirements, pensions, health benefits, the interaction between employers and unions, safety and health requirements, hiring and firing practices, and discrimination statutes. Verifying employment authorization, not expansion of a Christmas tree wish list of employment protections, should be the sole emphasis of an E-Verify mandate. That's one of the reasons we did not support the employment verification title in the Senate bill, and I will, in the question and answer, I will be happy to address that in more detail. The association is very encouraged by the Legal Workforce Act's emphasis on keeping it simple, a workable national E-Verify system. In summary, it would be easy to ignore the real concerns of the business community with a national E-Verify mandate, simply passing a law requiring its use. It is harder to pass a responsible E-Verify mandate that accommodates the different needs of the close to 8 million employers in the U.S. In the National Restaurant Association's opinion, the Legal Workforce Act reaches the right balance, a broad federal E-Verify mandate that is both fast and workable for businesses of every size under practical, real-world working conditions. Thank you again for this opportunity to share my testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Amador. Mr. Connor.
Chairman Gowdy, Congressman Conyers, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the invitation to testify today. I am Chuck Connor, President and CEO of the National Council of Farmer Cooperatives. I am also here on behalf of the Agriculture Workforce Coalition. The AWC brings together nearly 70 organizations representing the diverse needs of farmers and agricultural employees and serves as the unified voice for agriculture on immigration issues. While the labor situation in agriculture has been a concern for many years, Mr. Chairman, it has now reached a breaking point. Today, large segments of American agriculture face a critical lack of workers. Specific to the topic at hand today, mandatory E-Verify, without addressing agriculture's broader labor crisis, would be devastating. As an industry, we recognize the need for interior enforcement. It just cannot be decoupled from addressing agriculture's workforce concerns. Despite the employer's best efforts, many, if not most, of the agriculture workforce does not have proper paperwork authority. Based on a study conducted by the American Farm Bureau Federation in 2014, an enforcement-only approach would cause American agriculture output to fall by $30 to $60 billion. It would decrease fruit production by 30 to 61% and vegetable production by 15 to 31%. The livestock sector would also see losses of up to 27%. American dairy farmers in particular would be impacted by an enforcement-only approach. For dairy farmers, their harvest comes twice a day, every single day. The dairy industry, with year-round needs, cannot use the current H-2A program as currently interpreted. Dairy farmers are left without any legal channel to find workers if U.S. workers are simply not available or not interested. Mr. Chairman, American agriculture's biggest challenge in the future is to increase our food output in order to meet the dramatic rise in food needs for a growing planet. A large decrease in our food production in the U.S. would have significant humanitarian consequences in the future. For agriculture, the ideal approach to solving the labor problem would be to provide a solution for the experienced workforce and a redesigned guest worker program. This then could be followed by a phased-in E-Verify program. Mr. Chairman, I doubt anyone on this subcommittee would question the integrity of America's law-abiding farmers and ranchers. The vast, vast majority of American farmers fully comply with the law. But the paper-based system created by Congress in 1986 is vulnerable to use of false documents. Employers, including farmers, are not experts at spotting false documents. So long as a solution is in place to ensure access to a legal, stable workforce for a legal and stable workforce, farmers would welcome a system that is simple, efficient, effective, and certain. Bills in recent years would have phased in E-Verify, with agriculture generally being last in line. These bills recognize agriculture's demographic challenges and its need for foreign labor. This is a bold thing for us to suggest, Mr. Chairman, but if this Congress were to pass reform legislation that truly addresses agriculture's workforce challenges, the industry could pursue a phase-in of E-Verify sooner rather than later. But in closing, let me just be very clear. The agriculture industry would be forced to oppose any E-Verify legislation that does not address the agriculture workforce crisis. E-Verify legislation without provisions to address the unique labor needs of agriculture will drive more of our farmers out of business and move more of our food production abroad where there is indeed abundant labor. I have never encountered anyone member of Congress or in our general public who believes that would be a positive outcome, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today.
Thank you, Mr. Connor. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Virginia, the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Goodlatte.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me direct my first question to Mr. Johnson with the chamber. You mentioned in your statement, I wonder if you would elaborate, in recent years, several states and localities have enacted their own E-Verify requirements. And what is the concern of the business community if more and more states continue to enact their own requirements as opposed to the federal government enacting a nationwide requirement?
It's one of practicality and human resource compliance, which is it's obviously easier to administer and instruct your HR people if you have one standard to tell them they need to comply with. And if that's the federal standard, that's the one they need to be they taught towards as distinguished from multiple standards across state lines. Is it possible? Sure, lots of things are possible, but it's extremely difficult. Further, Congressman, it's not just a question of the law on its books as they're written, because if you have state and localities enforcing those different laws, that enforcement itself has a different patina on it, which then your compliance people and your companies have to be trained on. So it's an extremely complex area, and we think it's simply one that's unworkable. I do note that, of course, the preemption language in Mr. Smith's bill does allow for some state enforcement with regard to when an employer is not using the federal E-Verify system. So the language in there seems to strike a balance.
Enforcement, but not having a separate method by which you verify. In other words, they can participate in enforcement, but not set up their own.
Right, exactly. Can't set up their own mechanism.
Well, let me ask Mr. Amador. You mentioned in your testimony concerns about some of the requirements in the Senate bill. The employment eligibility verification process set out in the Legal Workforce Act, Mr. Smith's bill, and last Congress's Senate immigration reform bill were quite different. What are some of the problems with the Senate bill's employment eligibility verification process?
I think the Senate version, by the time it was done with the amendments, it became something other than an employment verification system. It ended up becoming more like a labor law, employment law, and it created a new causes of action. It created an awkward incentive for undocumented workers to either file grievances against employers or to be able to stay once they were in proceedings by filing claims before they even decided whether they were bogus claims or not, they will get a visa. I mean, there were a number of other things in the bill. It made it easier to find discrimination provisions, in labor provisions. It became another labor law as opposed to an employment verification bill.
Ms. Blitzstein, do you agree that the Legal Workforce Act adequately restricts the number of documents that can be used to prove identity and or work authorization in order to help prevent fraud while at the same time allowing enough documents, understanding that not every person has every document?
I do believe that the Legal Workforce Act does an adequate job of restricting those documents. As I mentioned, a lot of them are documents. I've been doing this for almost 17 years, and some of them I've never seen. There is kind of a small percentage of documents that are seen, you know, 90% of the time. So I think having more clarity, having a more brief list would be very, very helpful and would help streamline the process for the employer and employee.
Thank you. And Mr. Amador, Mr. Connor expressed some concerns regarding the safe harbor provision. Can you discuss the current safe harbor provision in the Legal Workforce Act and how, as drafted, it is workable for
I must say, I mean, I guess you can take any language, and I have gotten calls, you know, from people that think they can make it stronger. My view is that I haven't seen stronger safe harbors in immigration law than the one that is currently on the bill. So could it be changed? I mean, everything could be changed, but the way I read it and the way I continue to read it, I haven't found anything that is stronger, and we support it, so we don't want that amended as it is right now. Thank you.
Got it. And Mr. Connor, you support employment verification. You want to see a legal temporary worker program for agriculture that would meet the needs of not just seasonal production, but also processing plants and dairies that are year-round, and we have provisions in this bill, unlike current law and unlike the Senate bill, and unlike other provisions that address more of those concerns than any that I've seen before, in terms of what I anticipate will follow, because I don't disagree with you that we're going to have a better system to determine who's lawfully here in the country and who's lawfully eligible to accept employment. But when we do, it's going to create a problem in agriculture, and we need to be prepared to address that. So I certainly look forward to working with you on that. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank the gentleman from Virginia. The chair will now recognize the ranking member from Michigan, Mr. Conyers.
Thank you, Chairman Gotti. I want to put forward a proposition to you and have everyone give me their view. I think E-Verify is perfectly okay, but bringing in an electronic employment verification system to agriculture presents some unusual problems, and that until we begin to deal with those first, as Congresswoman Sheila Jackson Lee pointed out, it's how we go about doing this. And so I'm in the position of being for the measure if we can take care of some of the problems. Oh, it's a cart before the horse type situation. And E-Verify is the cart. And we can't get there first. And so do you agree with me that there are some big problems? We talk about the immigration system being broken, et cetera, but do you see some difficulties in the agricultural sector that could be a negative, would not make E-Verify successful? What do you think, Mr. Johnson?
Yeah, it's a conundrum, there's no question about it.
Right.
I think the agricultural community or field is the poster child of this problem. It exists in other industries, but they clearly would be the most adversely affected with E-Verify being signed into law by the president. There's a lot of space between the lip and the cup here, and nothing else either right behind it or preceding it. Mm-hmm. The order of how things proceed in the House is something you all will have to figure out and work in the Rules Committee. I should note that, just for the record, that while we supported the Senate bill, we never said the House should take up the Senate bill, by the way. We always thought the House should do its own thing and figure out how to do it. As a former House staffer, I would never support a Senate bill and say the House should just take up a Senate bill.
Of course not.
And I told the Senate staff over there they were crazy. But yeah, these things are linked somehow,
right.
But so far we're in a period of gridlock,
sure,
and not moving on anything except perhaps border security, but that even that got pulled from the floor.
Right.
And
let me go to Attorney Blitzstein and see if she shares the view that it's the order that we proceed in that is critical and that could determine in agriculture, the ultimate success of E-Verify.
Representative Conyers, I would have to say that CUPA HR is not very familiar with the particular issues as related to the agricultural industry.
Yeah.
So we would have to put that under more consideration before we'd be able to offer an opinion on that.
All right. And Mr. Amador, Attorney Amador, you raised some of this question yourself in your commentary and in your written statement. Do you see the problem that I'm presenting, and is it a fair one?
On agriculture, we do not have
our
board when they decided our position. We were clear that we didn't want any exemptions for restaurants. We did not touch on the issue of agriculture, and we think Mr. Connor is probably in a better position
right
to talk about his industry.
Chuck Connor, you can finish up your observations on this point.
Let me make 2 points, if I could, Mr. Conyer. I think you're right, but our problem with E-Verify is kind of twofold. The first is more fundamental, and that is we know we have a workforce that constitutes, as you have noted, 50 to 70% of our hired workforce in agriculture that is not here with proper paperwork. And so to go to an E-Verification system, you know, as I have noted in my testimony, you would be removing large chunks of our workforce in place that is responsible for providing the food and feed for America today. And I don't think anyone wants that consequence. The second one is more specific to agriculture, and that is just in terms of how do we, you know, how do you go forward with E-Verify? And we do have, you know, unique needs. Just an anecdotal point, and that is my wife and I both have farms in Indiana. Not the most remote part of the world by any means, but when we go out there, sir, iPhones don't work. And I'm sorry, but they don't. And there are a lot more remote agricultural regions, you know, in the country that are dependent upon this. There's just a lot of structural issues that may sound good sitting here, but when you get out there in the field and you've got peaches to harvest and a storm is coming and you've got 12 hours to get them down, that, you know, there's some practical
in the real world, problems arise.
Very carefully.
And I thank you very much. I thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from the great state of Texas, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank the vice chairman of the subcommittee, Mr. Labrador, for letting me precede him with questions. Although coming third when talking about a specific bill usually means a lot of your questions have already been asked, and Mr. Goodlatte did a good job of that a few minutes ago. I have a couple left. Mr. Johnson, let me address my first question to you, and that is, I know you all have polled your members, and how do you respond to the occasional charge that I think is unsubstantiated that E-Verify is costly or burdensome? Have you found that to be the case?
Well, as I said, the study that's quoted by some, we had our economists go through, and it's amazing, Mr. Smith, and the analysis is in my written testimony about how the people who put that study together actually carved out from their conclusions the employers who reported zero costs, and they just calculated in the employers who reported costs. There's also a weird way that they hired people moving to the so-called JOLTS study, where they included people as new hires who are really promotions and promotions within a company. But look, the bottom line, Mr. Smith, is, you know, we have a great policy committees at the chamber. I have 200 people in my labor committee. I've got 60 or 70 on my immigration policy subcommittee. They're from all levels of the economy and companies. And those are the people I go out and ask. And they're out there where the rubber meets the road. And they're saying we can handle this, Raina.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Mr. Amador, I know you have lots of members. I meet them on a regular basis, and I'm really appreciative of their support. And I should say I thank you all for your support of this legislation and for your constructive criticism, Mr. Connor, as well. You've made some good suggestions. Mr. Amador, do you find that your members find E-Verify to be accurate? To what extent, according to your survey, do they find E-Verify to be accurate, and why do they like it?
Yes, we conducted a survey in 2012. We were able to crank the numbers by 2013. We introduced it as part of a statement for the record back in April of 2013. And the vast majority of the people that were using it, 80% said, you know, that we recommend it to others. The ones that did not recommend it, you know, they said that the issues were initially, you know, getting into training, but once they were using it, it was fine. Across all of the demographics, they said that they had nearly, actually 80% said they had 100% accuracy. And the one we allowed for comments in this survey, you know, and again, it was about 800, the one comment that they said, you know, is we would rather know earlier whether the person is tentative non-confirmed, because when they show up to work and they come tentative non-confirmed, at least in our industry, what happens is they don't show up the next day when confronted with, hey, you need to go and fix.
You actually anticipated my next question, which is, what is the advantage of knowing prior to someone's actually being hired having that be E-Verify conducted ahead of time?
I think it's twofold. There's an advantage to the employee that they would not have to take time off from work to go to the Social Security Administration or wherever they need to go to fix this problem, and is an advantage to the employer, because if there's any problem with an employee that is not work authorized, if they're going to disappear, you'd rather they disappear before they already have a shift and they already started working.
Right, okay, thank you, Mr. Amador. Mr. Connor, I understood you to say, and I just want to make sure this is the case, because it will be helpful, that you would support E-Verify if it was used in conjunction with a new guest worker program. Is that generally correct?
That's half of the story, okay. Mr. Smith. In addition to obviously needing a viable guest worker program, which we currently do not have with H-2A, we need a solution for our existing trained workforce that has been estimated to to be about 1.2 to 1.4 million people that are already working full times on our farms and ranches.
Right.
So our solution is twofold: guest worker program, a solution for our existing workforce, and with that, we are willing to talk to you. Still acknowledging agriculture has some unique interests, as I have identified, in a E-Verify program, but we would be willing to try and resolve them.
As you're aware, in the last Congress, this committee did pass and approve a very robust guest worker program. And so I was trying to see, and it sounds like, while you may not be able to commit to, you see the details and the language, and I understand that, but generally speaking, if there was a new guest worker program, you would understand why we would need to have E-Verify apply to it.
Well, again, I don't want to downplay the importance of guest worker program, and we appreciate your effort to try and make that program workable. It is very unworkable, provides less than 7% of our labor population in agriculture right now. But for us, again, we have trained people, in some cases employees on our farms and ranches that have been there for a very, very long time, years, if not, over 10 years.
I understand all that.
We've got to keep those. And
right.
Under the current E-Verify plan, we would lose those workers and lose
I see what you're trying. So you're concerned about the ones who are working now. If we could address that, then that would clear the way for you.
Those
I understand
two
that.
Points, yes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Conner. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman from Texas. The chair will now recognize the general lady from Texas, Ms. Jackson Lee.
Well, Mr. Conner, I don't know if we can piecemeal repair some aspects of what you've spoken about, but we all know that the agricultural industry is tantamount to a major contributor to the economy, but it is also the breadbasket of the United States, of course, but around the world.
Yes.
So we are concerned and very interested in making sure that we take the right pathway. As you well know, although you've been discussed over the years, agricultural workers, special carve-outs and legislation, you were quite well responded to in a comprehensive approach when we were talking about comprehensive immigration reform. You remember that?
Yes.
And you remember that those efforts were made quite strongly on your behalf?
Yes.
So I want to just ask the question of where we are today. Yesterday, we held our first hearing for the House Judiciary Committee in the 114th Congress. It was interesting to me that out of all people in the world, the majority asked two people from the Center for Immigration Studies to testify. Earlier this week, a policy analyst from the same Center for Immigration Studies wrote an opinion piece in The Hill that characterizes people who employ undocumented workers as law-breaking employers who want their illegal labor to get work permits. I ask unanimous consent to enter that article into the record.
Without objection.
Thank you. To you, Mr. Connor, considering that a large majority of farm workers are unauthorized to work, 50 to 70%, do you think that the more than 1 million farmers that you represent are lawbreakers? Is that a fair characterization of the situation they find themselves in? And if you would just take this other, and if you'd give me an answer, please. One thing about that characterization is that it makes the employers seem greedy, purely self-interested. And as much work as we've done to improve the quality of life of ag workers, I take issue with that assessment. Can you talk a little bit about the work that undocumented farms do and how farmers think about their workers?
Well, Congresswoman, thank you for the question. It's a great question. And I will just tell you, I've spent my entire career, 36 years, working on agricultural policy in this town. And I just am passionate about the fact that our farmers absolutely want a solution to this problem. Are they lawbreakers? Absolutely not. They are collecting the proper paperwork from these workers. They are prohibited from questioning any information on that paperwork by law, with sharp penalties if they do. And they are proceeding forward and following the intent of the law. Now, again, we all acknowledge that paperwork is prone to be wrong at times. That is not the fault of the farmer and the people doing the, you know, the employing in this case.
And so clearly you would need some major, if you will, accommodations for any law that would ask and put more burdens on farmers. Let me ask you another question. You say that the farm jobs are not meant for the unskilled. That's my understanding too. I've heard that farm workers must have proper understanding of soil quality, fertilizers, irrigation, and cultivating techniques. For example, they need to know how to prune an apple tree without damaging it, or how to determine which berries are ripe enough to pick, or oranges, or how to pick a cucumber before it is too large to be marketable. That looks like a lot of skills that are needed. Can you provide more information about the necessary skills that farm workers must have? Is this a job that anyone can do? And then follow up, is that why you support legislative reform that includes an eventual path to a green card for current experienced unauthorized agriculture workers, which is certainly a concept of comprehensive immigration reform? Mr. Kanya?
Well, again, Congresswoman, thanks for the question. It's good. And I will just say that, you know, in our view, these workers are skilled workers. The work is very, very difficult, you know, sometimes involving very, very long days, hot sun, working around animals. You know, that working around animals is not something for the unskilled. You just don't pull somebody in and throw them in, you know, amongst dairy animals and expect safety and proper care of the animals. These are skilled workers. We pay them accordingly, as is demonstrated by, you know, wage rates for average workers that we can submit for the record as well.
I would appreciate if you would do that. Thank you for your answer. I'd like to ask Mr. Johnson, if I might. Mr. Johnson, first of all, I appreciate your accommodation in being interested in this legislation, offering suggestions. And I do recall working very closely with the chamber over a number of years on the idea of comprehensive immigration reform. You testified that before being subject to E-Verify, agricultural employers must have access to a workable program to sponsor lawful workers. This bill contains no provisions pertaining to an agricultural visa program, nor does it provide an opportunity for current farm workers to earn legal status. It does, however, require all agriculture employers to use E-Verify within 24 months. If the Legal Workforce Act is not paired with an agricultural visa reform, and you've heard Mr. Conner, the kind of reform reflected in S-744, H.R. 15, or the old Ags Job Compromise, which I've been on this committee long enough to know that plan, would the chamber still be in a position to support it, given the crucialness of those provisions for our agricultural industry?
The gentlelady's time has expired, but Mr. Johnson, you may answer the question.
Yeah, and I think there are several levels to as you well went under the legislative process. If E-Verify went to the floor without an ag fix before that or at the same time, what would our position be? I'm not sure. I think it's incredulous to think that would happen. But certainly, I would think, subject to further review at the chamber, that before an E-Verify bill went to the president for signature, the ag issue would have to be solved. And the chamber would reevaluate its position at that time if that was not going to occur.
Well, thank you for noting the defect of the legislation and the importance of moving forward on comprehensive immigration reform. But thank you all for your testimony. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlelady from Texas. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Idaho, the vice chairman of the subcommittee, Mr. Labrador.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Conner, for being here today. As you know, I come from an agriculture state. I understand the need that we have. I do find it just as a point of interest that it seems like the Democrats on this panel have no problem with EPA regulations when it affects agriculture, has no problems with the Waters of the USA legislation when it affects agriculture. The only time they ever have a problem with regulation in agriculture is when we're trying to stop the hiring of illegal and undocumented workers. I just want to put that out there for the record, because all the other stuff that's affecting your industry, they have absolutely no concern about. In fact, they're pushing for that kind of legislation and that kind of regulation that has an ill and deleterious effect on your industry. But I that's not what you're here to testify about. Are you aware that we passed in the 113th Congress a bill out of this committee that dealt with your needs in agriculture, that dealt with hiring of the people that are here undocumented right now? It added the dairy industry to the H-2 program, and it created a new system for agriculture to deal with their guest worker needs.
Congressman, I'm assuming you're referring to the guest worker legislation that was considered. And as I noted with Mr. Smith's comments as well, You know, we appreciate the effort to improve the current guest worker program because it is in great need of improvement. Is not used by very many producers out there, particularly small producers. You know, they don't have HR personnel, they don't have lawyers, they can't afford them.
Correct.
They can't navigate the current system. So we appreciate that work, but it's not, you know, close to being, you know, the solution to the problem that
I understand that you don't think it's close, but it was a beginning. It was a first step in trying to fix the problem that we have with the immigration system, especially with regards to agriculture.
The guest worker program is in need of improvement. Absolutely.
Okay. And do you realize that not a single Democrat in this committee voted for that bill?
I was not aware of that.
Sir. Okay. So when I sit here and I listen to the pontification about how we're not willing to do anything with regards to immigration, I want the people to understand that the Democrats were not willing to work with us on a step-by-step approach. Are you aware, and this is not your industry, but are you aware that we actually passed in the 112th Congress the STEM visa bill that would have dealt a lot with the problems that we have with the high-tech immigration? Are you aware of that?
Yes, I am aware, sir, but again, I add that, you know, we've got to deal with this in its totality. That is guest workers, that is our existence.
So what you're here to testify is that unless we do the Senate bill, then it's unacceptable. Is that what you're saying?
Well, one without the other really doesn't work for American agriculture. We do need a complete solution.
I agree with you. I agree with you 100% that we need a complete solution. Mr. Johnson, are you aware that we, in the 112th and 113th Congress, tried to pass immigration legislation that would have dealt with the high-tech immigration needs of the United States?
Yes, out of this committee. You did pass,
right.
Yes.
And actually, in the 112th Congress, we
right.
passed it out of the House,
right.
And the Senate would not even take it up. And we were told that the president would not accept that legislation because the president believed that it was either everything or nothing. And I think that's the frustration that I have. I agree with Mr. Connor that we have to fix the entire immigration system. I agree that agriculture has some needs that are unique to the agricultural industry. But to sit here and pontificate about how we have not done anything about immigration is just plain false. It's absolutely false. We have tried to do a step-by-step approach that where we have tried to fix the immigration system, and we have been held hostage by the president and his party because they're unwilling to work on a step-by-step approach. All we're doing today, starting with the E-Verify legislation, is fix one of the problems that we have the immigration system. I think all of you have testified that it improves the current E-Verify system that I have had some problems with in the past as a former immigration practitioner. But I think we need to understand that unless we work together, unless we realize that we have to do this in a step-by-step way, what we're doing is we're allowing the people on the other side of the aisle to hold this issue hostage. We have not fixed this problem for 30 years, and we haven't fixed it because it has been an all-or-nothing approach. In fact, the President of the United States, when he was a senator, he promised the Bush administration that he would support comprehensive immigration reform. And guess what he did? He went to the Senate floor and he voted for poison pill amendments that killed the entire Bush immigration process. We would have had this problem solved many, many years ago if it weren't for this president when he was a senator. He promised the American people that the first thing he would do as president was going to do comprehensive immigration reform, and neither he nor his party did anything to fix the problem. So let's just start fixing the problem and let's move on with the solutions that Americans are craving.
Thank the gentleman from Idaho. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Puerto Rico, the former Attorney General, Mr. Pierluisi.
Thank you. Welcome all. I'm particularly pleased to see Angelo Amador here. You make me feel proud as a fellow Puerto Rican American. That's great. Mr. Conner, I understand that the council didn't endorse the Ag Guest Worker Bill in the 113th Congress. Is that right?
Well, I'm sorry, which bill, sir?
The Guest Worker Bill mm-hmm. that was just referred to by my colleague, Mr. Labrador.
That is correct, sir.
So the council didn't endorse that bill.
We did not endorse that bill because it really represents only part of the solution that is necessary out there, the big part of the solution being our existing workforce.
And do you know of any other group of growers or ag group that supported that bill?
Not that I'm aware of.
Thank you. Mr. Amador, in your written statement, you say that you're committed to fixing the broken immigration system, which includes legalization of a portion of the undocumented workforce, and that simply changing the E-Verify system will not be enough to fix an immigration system that has been collapsing for almost 30 years. I agree with you on that point, but can you explain why you think that changing the E-Verify system itself is not enough to fix our immigration system? Why is it important that any fix to our immigration system include provisions that would allow undocumented people to earn legal status?
Well, I think that one of the bigger issues for us is what happens moving forward. And I know you have heard about H2A program, which is for agriculture. There's no such program available for low-skilled workers in our industry. The last time I saw a workable solution, guest worker program, was Senator Kennedy was still alive and Bush was president. We cannot wait that long for, you know, we've been waiting and we haven't seen it from Democrats or Republicans to give us a guest worker program to be able to move forward. So what we have decided is, if there are good solutions to different pieces, we're going to support them. I didn't hear from any Democrat calling my office complaining about the fact that we supported deferred action for childhood arrivals. That is just one piece. And we said even then, well, that's just one piece. It only takes care of a very small population. It's children and all that. For those reasons, we support it. But E-Verify is another piece. And as more and more of my employers and restaurants are using it, they are complaining that, look, I start using it, I find somebody, I try to work with this good employee. At the end of the day, they're final non-confirmation. I have to let them go just to see them go work across the street at another restaurant that is not using the program. And that's just unfair competition. The government is mandating it. We are opposing the way the president mandated E-Verify for federal contractors. It doesn't have safe harbors. It doesn't have a number of things. We are glad that, you know, several years ago, then Chairman Lamar Smith, you know, sat with us and sat with others and said, what are the problems? So we shouldn't wait another 20 years to fix one portion of immigration just because no one seems to be in agreement on a guest worker program right now.
Yeah, thank you. In your testimony, you also argue that employers should be allowed to run potential hires through E-Verify and make the job offer conditioned on the final verification. Here's my concern about that. We already know some employers don't notify employees when they receive a TNC. Instead, they just terminate employment, and the employee never has the opportunity to contest the TNC and demonstrate authorization to work. If people could be run through E-Verify before starting employment, isn't it likely that even more people would never be informed of a TNC, which could be defective or false? They would simply be told that the company no longer needs the employee for that job. Doing this for a person who hasn't even showed up for work seems much simpler than doing it for a person who has already joined your workforce. Couldn't this kind of pre-screening of employees before the date of hire mean many more U.S. citizens and work authorized non-citizens will lose job opportunities?
I think, you know, from the practical perspective, the feedback that we've gotten is you do all of the other background checks. I mean, even drug check and all of these other things you do before the person shows up to work. We're not saying that you pre-screen before an offer is made. An offer has been made and you're being told, we're now gonna go and do this number of things. We're gonna check your references, we're gonna check you verify, whatever it is that you do. Being able to do all the other things, and we're not saying that it should be, it shouldn't be legal not to inform the worker. You should inform the worker, number one, that you're gonna do an E-Verify check, and number two, what comes back. The whole idea is to allow this employee to fix it before they show up to work.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen from Puerto Rico. The chair would recognize the gentleman from Colorado, the former district attorney, Mr. Buck.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Blitzstein, I have a quick question for you about the safe harbor provisions. During a May 22, 2013 hearing before this committee, former ICE Assistant Secretary Julie Myers Wood commented that ICE operates under the assumption that the existence of a high number of employees who circumvent the system through identity theft contradicts the company's argument that it relied in good faith on its E-Verify confirmation. ICE's position deprives the employer of the E-Verify safe harbor under current law and exposes the company to legal liability for failing to detect and deter identity theft, notwithstanding its good faith use of E-Verify. I've heard these stories from many constituents in my district. I'm wondering whether this bill fixes that, whether you are comfortable with the safe harbor provisions in this bill that will be introduced soon.
We are comfortable with the safe harbor provisions. We do think it will further protect employers. Again, my personal experience at NC State is that we have used the system to terminate some employees when we've gotten a final non-confirmation. Fortunately, we never had those employees come back to us for any reason, but we were certainly relying on the fact that we were using the system as intended. We got that final non-confirmation result and then relied on it to make our employment decision. So we do very much feel that the provision in this particular bill will be more helpful to employers to get about their business of verifying their workforce, making sure they're not employing people without authorization at a more comfortable level.
Great. Thank you. Mr. Johnson, I have a question for you. The President has undermined the immigration system with his executive orders, prosecutorial discretion, and his use of resource allocation. My question is, what prevents the President from ignoring this law as he has so many others?
Well, that's an interesting question based on issues of standing and the natural fact that no matter how restrictively this body writes a law, there's always going to be some discretion written into anything you write. You know, look, you have the power of the purse to rein in the president. Of course, the speaker has filed a case against the president under Obamacare. Congressman, I'm not going to pretend. Really, it's at some point. You can say we don't trust the president and do nothing, because you're not going to be able to write a law that doesn't depend on some degree of the president exercising his discretion. But if you take the position we don't trust the president, well, that the follow-on on that is, well, we may as well not do anything in this body.
That's not what I'm suggesting at all. I'm suggesting there are pieces of this law that require executive action. There is a computer system that needs to be set up. There are various activities that need to be engaged in good faith. There are contracts that need to be let to the private sector to upgrade the system. And my question is, in what way do we know that the president's going to do these things?
Right, and the only answer is you can't write those more restrictively probably than they're already written, because they are very detailed administrative functions, and really the answer is a strong oversight through this committee. Of course, you're in the majority now.
Would it help if we had time frames and requirements that the administration report back?
Administrations, Republican and Democrat, and I've been in both, often meet deadlines, miss deadlines. Occasionally they meet them. The real answer to that is your oversight and calling the officers up here from the administration and saying, what the heck's going on out here? You're in charge of this law and you're in charge of the government. Why aren't you meeting these deadlines? And then, frankly, you have the blunt instrument of trying to cut their budget in some ways to send a signal to them, or use committee report language, which we often do when I was up on the Hill, to send a signal of them to get their act together. But there's no real clean answer to that. Okay. Sorry.
I yield back. Thank you.
The gentleman from Colorado. Before we go to the gentleman from Texas, we're going to briefly go to the gentleman from Puerto Rico.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if there's no objection, I would like to introduce in the record a statement from the American Immigration Lawyers Association, as well as a letter from the American Farm Bureau Federation.
Without objection. Chair, I thank the gentleman from Puerto Rico. The chair would now recognize the gentleman from Texas, the former United States Attorney, Mr. Radcliffe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's no secret that when ICE opens a worksite enforcement matter, it's usually based on information or intelligence that there is a workforce of illegal aliens at a particular company. And one of the things that a prosecutor wants to find out early in the investigation before making any charging decisions is whether the employer had knowledge or reason to believe that illegal aliens were, in fact, part of the company's workforce. When I was a prosecutor in such cases, and the employer was relying solely on the I-9 process, whether an employer was subjected to penalties and fines ultimately hinged on prosecutorial discretion, namely whether I was persuaded that counterfeit documents, sometimes for hundreds of employees, could in fact be mistaken as genuine or authentic. by the employer. That coupled with the fact that I never had a worksite enforcement action against an employer that used E-Verify seems to provide anecdotal evidence that E-Verify is a great protection for employers. But again, that's anecdotal. So I want to get some testimony in that regard. And I want to start with you, Ms. Blitzstein. In the years, as I understood your testimony, for 8,000 employees that have gone through and been subjected to E-Verify, can you talk briefly and hopefully quantify whether there were instances where E-Verify did in fact identify I-9 process documents that were false, even though they may have looked valid on their face?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Trott. I'd like to say, at least for NC State, we actually probably at this point, after using the system for 8 years, we've probably E-verified about 30,000 employees over the course, because usually during when the semester is underway, but when you add in the additional 8,000 students and other workers, then our workforce doubles to 16,000+ during an academic year. So over 8 years, people come and go, about 30,000. Off the top of my head, I can tell you, I can remember very distinctly two incidents where people presented false green cards. One of them was actually very good, and the system came back with the final non-confirmation. We let the person go. I studied it for a while and finally was able to see some of the flaws. One of the other fake green cards was actually rather terrible, and so once I got involved at my level and saw it, I knew right away. But we let E-Verify just kind of clean up the process there. But so we have had those two. I would have to say that our industry is higher education, and so we probably have smaller rates of people without documentation trying to pass themselves off. We really don't experience it to the same degree that I'm sure some other industries probably do. But at this point now, we are very reliant on the system. After 8 years, we're required by the state. We're going to keep using it probably indefinitely. But it still is, again, the safe harbor idea is very attractive for us. And in, you know, over 30,000, I can remember those two. There might be a few others, but I would probably say less than 10 over the 8 years we've been using it, where we actually were dealing with something that might be related to fake or false documents.
Okay, thank you. And you mentioned safe harbor, and I apologize. I know there's been some testimony, and I've gone in and out. But Ms. Blitzstein, you offered a number of recommendations in your testimony about ways that you believe that the Legal Workforce Act could be improved. But one of them didn't include any changes to the safe harbor provisions. Do I take that as an endorsement of the current safe harbor provision?
That is correct. We did not see any additional need for improvement based on what was already in the Act.
Okay, and I thank you. And Mr. Amador, you already spoke to you spoke to that issue, and so I think I'm clear on that point. I think you called it the strongest language that you'd seen thus far with respect to safe harbor.
Correct.
Okay. So what I'm not clear is, Mr. Johnson, do you have a have you given testimony with respect to that? And if not, on behalf of many folks associated with the chamber, your thoughts on that?
Well, we've had a lot of experts look at this language, litigators, before we agreed to it, and we think it's solid. You know, as more and more individuals and experts look at it, there may be a tweak here and there that we can recommend to the committee, but as of right now, we're satisfied with it.
Terrific. Great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank the gentleman from Texas. The chair would now recognize himself. Mr. Connor, I want to start with you, and I want you to deliver this message for me, because it's really, really important that this message be delivered. The Secretary of Agriculture in South Carolina is a longtime friend of mine named Hugh Weathers, who happens to be a dairy farmer.
He's a good man.
He is a good man. And he married into the very first family that helped me when I ran for district attorney. So if anybody's wondering who to blame, it would be the Grambling family from South Carolina, and they are peach farmers. So I am keenly aware of agriculture's interest, and so is our chairman, who is the architect and the author of an agricultural bill which the South Carolina Farm Bureau endorsed last session. We necessarily cannot have simultaneous hearings, or at least I have not figured out how to have simultaneous hearings. So you have to start with one. But I do not want you, and I would ask you to take back to the farmers, the fact that we started with E-Verify in no way, shape, or form means that we are not cognizant of the issues that the agriculture community faces. So if you would let them know how much we appreciate them. And we had to start somewhere. Had we started with the ag bill, then other folks would have been critical of us for going in that chronology. So if you can help me get that message to your constituency, I would be most grateful to you. Mr. Johnson, I know the chairman asked Mr. Amador, but I want to hear from you as an entity that had overall support for the Senate immigration bill, but yet had some concerns about their E-Verify process. What were those concerns with particularity?
Well, the safe harbor language is better than in the House bill. There's a crazy provision in the Senate bill that deals with the so-called U visa, which is a narrow visa for people who testify in sort of criminal and very egregious kinds of cases. It was expanded to cover virtually any kind of workplace complaint, which we viewed as an incentive, really, for someone to come forward and file a complaint against an employer, because the result of that would be they could not be deported from the country while that event was pending. They frankly changed the legal authority of the Office of Special Counsel over there from enforcing intentional discrimination to intentional plus unintentional discrimination, i.e. disparate impact, which, since I did my graduate paper in that area, I was particularly annoyed by. And they have a whole matrix of sort of appeals when the tentative non-confirmation comes back, that the employee could stay on the payroll forever while this mousetrap of appeals was going forward. And look, Mr. Chairman, there has to be a balance here, but there's no perfect answer in a lot of cases, and you've got to balance giving the employee a chance to correct their records if, in fact, there's a mistake, which I think Mr. Smith's bill does, versus creating a whole matrix of other requirements and lawsuits which our members aren't just going to buy into. I've got a treatise on my desk. It's 2,000 pages long, just talking about what employers must comply under our few civil rights laws. We've got enough litigation. We've got enough gold mines for plaintiffs' lawyers without creating more.
Correct me if I'm wrong, if my memory serves, U visas would be utilized by victims of domestic violence, hypothetically, in one area, so they could come forward and cooperate with law enforcement and not have any fear of any legal consequence for coming forward, and then that was expanded in the Senate version to include labor violations.
Workplace disputes.
Okay. Ms. Blitzstein, your written testimony stated that you had developed a successful program for handling foreign national scholars and graduate students who are coming to the U.S. for the first time and necessarily do not have a Social Security number. What is that process?
We have developed a system where, especially with our electronic system now, we're able to do the I-9 without the Social Security number, because when they first come, they have to wait about 10 days after entering the U.S. before they're eligible to apply for a number at the Social Security Administration. So we still do the electronic I-9. It's kind of pending until they go to Social Security. When they're able, get their number, they come back to us, we enter it, and then it gets pushed through to E-Verify. And for that process, the E-Verify 3-day time frame is suspended because there's just practically no way, and Social Security isn't going to turn it around that fast either. So we have developed that process that we have trained a number of our decentralized campus users of the E-Verify system on. It's still not perfect, which is why one of our suggestions was still to allow a little more time, because once the Social Security Administration gives the new number to the individual, they give it straight to them. They don't notify us as the employer when they have issued them the number. So we still sometimes need to work with the new employees to make sure they come back to us, provide us with that number so we can finish out the process. So we're still always searching for ways to improve and to make things even better, but that's our current system.
Thank you. I inadvertently overlooked, I don't know how, Mr. King, when he was here last time. I wanted to apologize to him and now recognize the gentleman from Iowa for his 5 minutes of questioning.
I thank the chairman for recognizing me and for holding this hearing, and I thank the witnesses for your testimony. Having listened to your testimony, a number of questions emerged, and I would direct my first one to Mr. Johnson, and that would be, there are limitations written in the bill on how an employer might verify an existing employee. And can you perhaps explain to this panel why? I'll make this assertion. If I'm an employer and I have an employee tell me that he's unlawfully present in the United States and can't legally work, but he has slipped through my bookkeeping system, why should I not be able to run him through E-Verify and deal with him according to the law?
Well, I think you would be able to, I think you would be able to deal with them under this system. You mean he slips through because of a false false paper?
Why couldn't I just, if I suspected an employee of being unlawfully working for me, why wouldn't an employer who had the best intentions of complying with the law, as Mr. Connor said is what people do, why couldn't that employer just go to E-Verify, run the data through E-Verify to see if that employee is actually lawfully can work?
Well, I think the bill does provide a process by which if the tenant of non-confirmation comes back that the employee has, I think it's right to give the employee a chance before he's fired to correct, to see whether or not the information is wrong when it comes back. And it's only 10 days under the bill, as I recall, and then the employer can fire the employee.
Let me suggest we're really not quite on point here, okay, because the bill has been improved from what originally was a couple of years ago, in that now the employer has to check everyone either within a geographic area or within a work category. And I suggest that that's an unnecessary limitation, although it's an improvement. And so I would move on from that, and thank you for your response. Also, it has a conditional job offer for an employee, potential employee. That's an improvement in the bill. But I'm concerned then, Mr. Johnson, about the preemption of the states and my concern has been in the past that if states are preempted from enforcement, and I understand in this now new version of the bill that they can enforce in parallel with and in mirror to the federal law. But if states are preempted and the federal government doesn't enforce, wasn't that one of the reasons for preemption in the first place, is that if the federal government doesn't enforce and we don't have to worry about the states doing that, as was the basis of SB 1070?
Mm-hmm. Well, I have the Section 6 language here in front of me on preemption, and it is quite complicated. I would say that it still allows the states to, even on its most restrictive reading, Mr. King, it allows the states to check whether or not the employer is complying with federal E-Verify rules and regulations, and if not, step in. I think it's perhaps a little unclear on whether or not does the state have power beyond simply removing the license for that business to operate.
But also to levy fines.
And levy fines.
And retain those fines.
And retains them. So to me, this was a balance that, as I said before, we would have preferred a broader preemption, but this does allow the states to have a role. It's obviously a smaller one than after the Supreme Court's decision in Whiting.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I appreciate it. I'd like to turn to Mr. Connor. And I was interested in the percentages that you gave, the different components of agriculture in particular, that could be the potential losses if there was a mandatory E-Verify brought abruptly without time to adjust to that. Can you tell us how those numbers, those percentage losses, were calculated?
Certainly, Congressman King. Those numbers were the result of a study by the American Farm Bureau Federation, and we would be happy to provide that full study with those results for the committee record if you so choose that.
Could I ask you to do that and ask if the chair at his discretion might forward that on to the committee members, the Farm Bureau analysis?
Yes, sir.
I thank the chairman of the committee for that. And he also mentioned that there was as much as a 50% wage or a worker rate that wouldn't be in compliance right now. Did I hear that correctly?
Yeah, we have an existing workforce of about 1.2 to 1.4 million, and that, the estimates of what that constitutes is somewhere between 50 to 70% that we believe probably would not have proper work authority in this country.
I'm fairly shocked by that, but I have I would go further with these questions, given, and just make this a concluding statement instead, Mr. Connor, and that is that it appears to me over my working life, all of it within sight of cornfields and soybean fields and agriculture, as you know, that this country has evolved into a high dependency on illegal labor, particularly in agriculture. And I can replay this through my mind's eye on what it would look like today if that weren't the case, if these 50 states were islands unto themselves rather than a continent that allowed for a flow of labor. And I just make this point at conclusion. There are 92,898,000 Americans of working age who are simply not in the workforce. And to all employers out there, I would suggest that if you need one, you can find one from that list. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, gentlemen from Iowa. I would, in conclusion, ask unanimous consent to enter into the record statements from the Society of Human Resource Management and the National Federation of Independent Business This concludes our hearing today. I do want to thank every one of our witnesses for your expertise, your collegiality among one another and with the committee, and your cordiality with the same. We all benefited from your expertise, and we thank you. Without objection, all members will have 5 legislative days to submit additional written questions for the witnesses or additional materials for the record. With that, the hearing is adjourned.